Hey YouTube, what's going on? Last year, around Black Friday, I decided I was going to get a new camera for astrophotography, and I was using a first generation SBIG ST8300, and I wanted to go with something that was a little bit more noise free, a little bit more modern. That camera was maybe 8 years old, and it was starting to show its age, and so I did a lot of research, and it ended up settling with the ZWO ASI 1600 monochrome cooled pro. I threw together a little spreadsheet that looks like this. So in this spreadsheet, I created a little matrix, and this matrix has a couple of common manufacturers like ZWO, SBIG, ATIC, QSI, and QHY. I picked a couple of different models that were kind of within budget, trying to figure out which one of those features mattered the most, where it stacked up against the competition, and then the price of the camera, and I was trying to find the best bang for my buck. It's not that important how much electric charge can be stored per photo site, and I think the reason behind why that's not that important is the quantum efficiency of the sensor is actually more important. Another factor that isn't too important is the read noise. And the reason why read noise is not all that important is we do dark frame subtraction and a bunch of other things to help offset the contribution of the read noise when we download these images. But a couple of things that to me were important were things like the dynamic range and the quantum efficiency. And then I assumed that the bit depth of the ADC was also going to be a big factor. And I'll get into that in just a little bit. The signal to noise ratio, this is a fairly important feature of a camera, but again, we stack a lot of photos and we calibrate those photos. So the signal to range ratio on each individual subframe, while it's important, it's the sum of the parts, basically. The more photos you take that are quality photos, the less important your actual subframe signal to noise ratio is going to be. So the purpose of this video is actually to investigate this column here. This is the ADC bit depth. And what that means is when it doesn't matter what camera you use, when you record a FIT file on your machine or whatever file it is that you're actually saving, it's going to be a 16-bit file. And the only exception to that would be JPEG. I think JPEGs are limited to only 8 bits. To make a 16-bit FIT file, intuitively you would think that having 16 bits of data coming off the sensor through an ADC that has a 1-to-1 conversion ratio to that 16-bit file is going to be the way to go, because every bit that's on the sensor winds up in the file. And if you have a, say, 8-bit ADC, then you have to multiply that bit value by 2 to come up with the 16-bit that gets written into the file. So does that hurt the camera's performance when you're recording the data? Does it mess the data up a little bit? And so I looked at some of these, and I've got 12 bits and then 16 bits. And obviously, if you're going to make a 16-bit file, the 16-bit ADC is probably going to be better than the 12-bit. I didn't really have much choice in the matter on this. I could not afford some of these $4,000 or $8,000 cameras that are on the list, but I could easily swallow the $1,300 investment at the time. With the Black Friday sales that were going on, this price actually went down, and I was able to get the ASI 1600 mono, a filter wheel, and a set of ZWO filters for a price that I could afford. So I decided 12 bits to 16 bit probably isn't gonna matter that much. I know that my DSLR does 14 bit, but I can pull a 16 bit raw file off of it, and those 16 bit single raws look okay, but if I'm gonna be stacking a lot of files, maybe that 12 bit isn't gonna matter a whole hell of a lot. So I kind of sat and thought about this for a while, and you know, here we are about 3 months after I received the camera, and you know, I've done a great deal of thinking on it, and I've actually reached the conclusion that it doesn't matter. So let me explain to you why it doesn't matter. The first thing that we need to talk about is, what is an ADU? An ADU is an analog to digital unit, okay? And those are created in the ADC, which is the analog to digital converter. And so there's a couple of different ADU values that you can have The most common ones that I've seen in astrophotography are either 12-bit or 16-bit, but I'm sure with DSLRs, 14-bit should be included as well. So I've included on my little list of camera ADUs in bits that I'm testing in this model, 2-bit, 4-bit, 12, 14, and 16. So I'm going to walk you through a few mathematical models that I created using this spreadsheet here to kind of give a visual representation of the data that we're going to be working with. So the first thing that I want to show you is what happens if you had a hypothetical camera that could only record a 1 or a 0. Either light hit the sensor or light never hit the sensor. If light hits the sensor, it's saturated. It doesn't matter if it's a single photon or 1,000 photons, it's going to look the same. And if no light hits the sensor, it stays a 0. Our hypothetical sensors is going to record these 5 subframes, and that's what these little black borders here are. The sensor value, this little square of 16 pixels is the first image, this is the second image, and so on and so forth. And I randomized this data. Seeing conditions can change, the amount of light that you get because of, you know, sky transparency could change from one exposure to the next, the amount of noise that's inherent to the sensor, it could possibly change these values a little bit. And then I ran it through an ADU that I designed, which is an incredibly simple ADU, and I don't mean that that's like a brilliant design. I mean, it's literally just the simplest ADU that you could conceive of to accomplish this goal. A simple algebraic expression. So in this case, this is a single bit camera trying to record value as a 2-bit file. And so we see that this number 1 here gets converted to a number 4 here. And that's what happens. Multiply 1 times 2 raised to the power of 2. And so these are the new raw data. These would be the TIFF files saved to your hard drive here. And when you stack them, you actually get this. And if you actually have values in here that are a 2, you've got a 3 down here, and a whole bunch of 4s, and then a 0. And what this is telling me is it doesn't matter if the data you're recording has to be scaled up to a higher bit value. When you stack them, you can average closer to the approximate value of what that real data in the sky would have been. The same exercise using basically the exact same data, but we're going to go from a 1-bit camera going through a 4-bit conversion. And so the same 1, when it's multiplied by 2 raised to the power of 4, so we either have a maximum value of 16 or a minimum value of 0. There are no in-between values in our JPEGs, and we get, again, data in between the max and min values when we stack. You can actually see the gradients here versus the gradients here, they actually change a little bit. You get a little bit lighter color here when you're looking at a 1-bit to 4-bit conversion instead of a 1 to 2. When you're averaging things together, you can find out a little bit closer to the more approximate value there. So I took it a step further and I did a 1-bit camera scaled up to a full 16-bit FIT file. The same 1 value actually now scales to either 65, 535, or a 0. When stacked, you get these values that are in between. And again, the colors change ever so slightly here. This one right here would be one of the more notable ones to pay attention to. It's a lot less dark. And that's because the average, with that wider dynamic range, it's able to figure out a little bit more precisely where it should have been in between. So the camera that I'm using is a 12-bit to 16-bit camera. And this is totally randomized data. Now this one is a little bit more of a sophisticated model because I'm not dealing with either a 1 or a 0. So what I did is I programmed these cells here in this first image to randomly assign a value between 1 and 4096. 4096 is the maximum value in a 12-bit stream of data. Every image after that uses this data as the base data, but randomly adds or subtracts a value that is plus or minus 5% of the original value. And so that gives me a 10% range where the data can fluctuate randomly. And then when we convert the 12 bits to 16 bits, the conversion actually looks pretty close to the same as we had over here on the main sensor. And when I stack, The stack also looks a lot like the originals and the converted ones as well. The gradient changes are not that severe. And so that tells me that when you step from 12-bit to 16-bit, the conversion itself doesn't skew the data all that much. And when you stack it, you were already pretty close to what the real values would have been during the scaling. The averaging doesn't actually have the ability to change the data all that much, which is promising. It means that you're not losing data with a 12-bit camera. And I took it a step further for all of us DSLR people out there with a 14-bit image. Completely randomized data up here at the top, and then a plus or minus 5% variance in each pixel down here when we convert from 14-bit to 16-bit, and then stack those five, which is just a simple average stacking, the stack data looks very similar to the sensor values and the source data as well, or the raw data. So going from a 14-bit to a 16-bit, if you had a 14-bit sensor and it creates a 16-bit raw value, I don't think that a 16-bit camera is actually required for astrophotography. I mean, they do exist. And the fact that they do exist means that there's probably some sort of academic or research grade application where these cameras absolutely must have a one-to-one relationship between what it is that's recorded and what it is that they measure when they're analyzing the data. But I'm not doing research, and if you're watching this video, you probably don't do much actual research yourself. You're into this hobby for the purposes of creating art. You know, astrophotography in the mainstream is more of an artistic endeavor than it is a research or a academic endeavor. And that's not to say that you can't do it, but you know, nobody is studying the Orion Nebula by going to Instagram and looking at my photos or the photos of any other mainstream astrophotographer out there. You know, there's not going to be any new discoveries that come out of that. If the purpose is making a beautiful looking photo, you don't need a 16-bit camera. You know, this little model, which is a very simple model, you know, I don't take gain, I don't take offset, I don't take calibration or any of that other stuff into account here. It's just a simple randomization of data, running it through a very simplistic ADC algorithmic formula, and then averaging five frames. I mean, it's a really simple model, but it proves a point that a 1-bit camera can produce 16-bit images that can give you some contrast between a minimum and a maximum value. And when you go from a 1-bit camera all the way up to a 12 or a 14-bit camera, you wind up getting a fairly close approximation of what the original data was on the sensor in your 16-bit files. And when you stack those, it doesn't change the data a whole lot. I really think that if you're in the market for an astrophotography camera, and you are okay with the fact that you're going to make art, and that art does not have to be 100% scientifically accurate, because you're going to stretch the data and you're going to apply sharpening tools and contrast enhancements, and you're going to do some false color, and you're going to tweak with the data anyway and completely destroy the scientific merit of the image, then by all means, save your money and go with either a 10 or a 12-bit camera, because I really don't think you're going to lose out on anything. What you want to pay attention to is your quantum efficiency and the amount of dynamic range that camera is going to have. Those two things are going to be the things that make your camera perform very well. If you're looking for a camera, I really suggest you do your homework, put together a spreadsheet like this, do your research into what makes a camera perform the way it does, create a matrix kind of like what I have here, pick the things that matter to you. These were the things that mattered to me. And you might look at my matrix and realize, why does he care about this, or why does he care about that? It doesn't make sense to me. Then you know what? Figure out what matters to you, create your own matrix, and make your own decision based off of your criteria, not the criteria that I thought was important to me. That being said, if you want to have a copy of this, you know, comment in below. I'll find a way to get a copy of it off to you so you can at least look at it and doctor it up if you need to, get rid of the things you don't need, add the things you do want, and you can begin to research your own camera that way. I'm going to bid you all farewell. I hope you thought this exercise was interesting. I thought it was a really cool thought experiment, and I've been mulling on it for a few months. Hope you guys have clear skies, and I'll see you in the next one.